right to begin without thank yous. So first, just allow me to give some thanks because this is all possible, at least for me, through the U.S. Department of Education and the Title VI grant for Middle Eastern Studies that was awarded here at Johnson County Community College. Also, the Fulbright Foundation that were our host. I traveled with a team of scholars. Oh, yes, thank you so much. I needed you to give me a kiss. Thank you. I appreciate that. I've traveled with a team of 14 scholars throughout Morocco for 5 weeks. And we're going to take you on that journey. The person that assembled the team, I don't think he's here this evening, but he merits a thank you as well. Professor Bob Perry, he's the Professor Emeritus of Sociology here at Johnson County Community College, and Professor Samira Hussein, the business area. I thank them both. They were co-leaders in this journey.
Angel, who provided some introduction.
And everything you've done to make this evening possible. Professor Terry Erickson, happy birthday to you for the beautiful program she designed for us that has a whole list of links in here that hopefully you'll take with you and visit on Turkey and other things. I feel like I know you already. And a special thanks to you, Aishanor Kalabar, and your group. Thank you for sharing this evening with me. Are you ready to get on the magic carpet?
Yeah.
Because we're heading off to Morocco. Now, you know, I think everyone here is well aware that Morocco and Turkey are very distinct countries, but they do share some things in common. So I'd like to highlight some of those things because it's beautiful to know that we really are of one world, and we are, in some ways, of unique experiences, but yet common experiences. So both countries have a history dating back to the Neolithic period, more than 100,000 BC, imagine that. They both have borders that touch the Mediterranean Sea. I know Turkey has borders touching many other seas, the Black Sea as well, and that's the area that I think we'll learn more about tonight as well. But because of the touch of Mediterranean, the countries have seen influences, such as the Phoenicians, the Carthaginians, the Romans, the Greeks, the Byzantines, and the Arabs. And we'll see that influence in these films. Both countries have a very diverse ecosystem, beautiful seascapes, plains, and mountainous regions. And this, of course, has given rise to a variety of plant and animal life, unique to those countries. Both countries have parliamentary governments. Morocco, albeit, has a parliamentary monarchy that is headed by a king, and Turkey has a parliamentary democracy, and you have a prime minister. Both countries have shared some influences. This is my obligatory academician part of this presentation. Both countries share some influences that have come from Arabia, and this includes religion and also artifacts such as architecture, and you'll see that in these films. So this evening I originally, and in the program, planned on showing one film. They're both very short films. The first one is On the Road, it's 12 minutes in length. But you know, this morning I kind of went through that, and I thought, oh my goodness, I never really show that film in isolation, and if I show just that one film, it's not going to give you enough of a view. So I'm going to show another short film on Fez, which is the oldest city in Morocco. And it's 7 minutes, so I think that we can get it all done in a good amount of time. So regarding the films that you will see, you'll notice that the films, with very few exceptions, focus solely on landscape, city environments, and architecture, not people. That was purposeful. Number one is respect to people, not to be voyeuristic. It was a respect of the culture, not to take pictures of people directly or even covertly. However, every once in a while we'll have a cameo shot of someone that crossed the viewfinder as I snapped. It was also designed in such a way so that we, as the viewers, feel that we're in that space on that journey. And so the photographs are like these crystalline fragments. Sometimes you're seeing large vistas, and sometimes you're just seeing an architectural detail, the way we glance around the space. The photographs have been set into motion, and they're choreographed to Moroccan music, so you get that feeling, and we'll have Turkish music later. So excited to hear. Now, here's an interesting fact. Each photo was taken with a very expensive point-and-click digital camera, a Pentax S10, many of them through the window of a moving vehicle. So when you see this, pay attention to that. You'll think, wow, she's good. How does she do that? You have to get really good at knowing exactly when to click. The other thing is about the photographs, they haven't been enhanced in any way. In other words, they weren't photoshopped to enhance color, and they haven't been cropped. It's like, you know what, I am the show me state. I'm actually from Missouri. I don't know, should I admit that? Anyway, what I saw is what you're gonna see. That's it. So on the road is what I'm gonna show you first. It'll give you this overview of the journey. And I'm gonna, in 5 weeks, imagine this. We traveled, 14 of us, in a small, really small minivan, from Rabat to Marrakesh. From Marrakesh to Essaouira, to Agadir. Agadir to Zagora. Zagora to Ouarzazate, where they make all those films, you know, like Lawrence of Arabia and stuff. It's like really big for the film industry, more than you would know. From Ouarzazate to Merzouga, from Merzouga to Erfoud, from Erfoud to Medelt, from Medelt to Ifrane, from Ifrane to Fez, and Fez to Rabat again, via Meknes. And Meknes isn't featured in a title slide, the rest of them are, it'll tell you where we're headed to. But Meknes you'll know by the Roman ruins of Alubias, witness to the influence of the Romans. So through the journey, you'll notice there are such incredible variety in the landscape. I think it's important to know that we travel in this little teeny minivan on these two-lane roads. The desert is alive there. Anyone that's lived near a desert or in a desert, you know that it's a living being. And it moves. The desert moves with the winds. It shifts. And sometimes the roads aren't even very visible because of the sand shifting. Morocco had been in a 15-year drought. So many of the things that you see that look like valleys or riverbeds that are dry, you'll feel the breath within the music, I think, and you'll get that sense of this journey. The musical selection is from the album titled Moroccan Spirit, and the song is Jalala 1. Nocturnal ritual, which loosely translated might be said the ritual of majesty in mind. Ready? Thank you. Greece. Oh, wait, no, I'm in Spain. Oh, wait, did you feel that way? Yeah, it's really amazingly diverse, and that's how, I mean, that's some of the real beauty of it, is that it has, Morocco has an accommodation that embraces all these different traditions, and yet is also independent of all those traditions. So quickly on to the last film. It's a short film, it's Fez. You saw some of the slides there, but I do think it's important, and let me tell you why. Fez is said to be the breath and the very heartbeat of Morocco. It's the oldest surviving city in Morocco, and it has a medieval influence. You'll see that it's a walled city. It was founded by the Arabs, actually, and interestingly enough, by Idris I, who is the great grandson of the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, the illuminated being that brought the Holy Quran, as we know it now. Or maybe not as we know it now. That's a whole other evening's discussion. It's open to interpretation, much like the Dead Sea Scrolls. So we will see the Arab influence in Fez, but we'll also see the influence of the Spanish and the French. Hence the word La Casbah. You saw that in one of the slides. So it's known as one of the major centers for learning for Islamic orthodoxy. The green tile on the roofs is like the signal. You know you're heading towards a place of prayer. These are the mosques. This is where people gather five times a day to pray. And the green color is associated with Islam. It's said to be one of the favorite colors of the Prophet. Fez is the home of the oldest university in the world, according to UNESCO. And guess what? It was founded by a woman. Fatima al-Khoury. And the place is called Jamiat al-Karawain. Jamiat means a place for gathering. It is a mosque and a madrasa. The madrasa is a university. And as I said, founded by a woman. I think that's quite extraordinary. Al-Karawain subsequently has become the leading spiritual and educational center for the historic Muslim world. And as I said, it is the oldest and continuously operating educational institution according to UNESCO. In 1956, Fez played a very significant role, very significant, because there is where the Moroccan independence movement started and subsequently gained liberation from French rule. The musical selection is from the album Moroccan Spirit. The song is Al Munia, and meaning safe haven. Thank you. single detail that seemed decorative was infused with religious principles. This was one of the great contributions that the Prophet Muhammad gave to that region, was to take away the religious iconography that created division and to express it in pure geometry. Any mathematicians here, we know what that means. Math is the ultimate truth. But each one of these designs signifies something, sort of the creation of the cosmos, expansion and compression and contraction. Life itself, the very lyrical forms are often the iteration of nature, which holds very many illuminating principles, as well as the lyrical forms are stylized Arabic script that are Quranic verse, surahs. So to us, it's just beautiful, but to a worshiper, it holds a very deep hidden message. And even if we contemplate them, something comes through for us. So I do want to say, if there's anything that's happened this evening thus far, and I know it's going to continue in a beautiful way, that's been beautiful or harmonious, I ask that that vibration go out and touch the families of the people that were killed recently, not so far from here. And that we can come to a place where we realize that we live in a shared world and we have a shared human experience. And that's what makes our life rich. It's the tapestry of this life. And may we have peace and overcome hatred and ignorance. I close with a poem by Mevlana Jalaluddin Rumi, 13th century poet. Out beyond the ideas of wrongdoing and rightdoing, there's a field. I'll meet you there. When the soul lays down in that grass, the world is too full to talk about ideas, language, even the phrase each other doesn't exist anymore.
You understand why at Johnson County Community College we are so proud of our scholars. You know, as a Johnson County Community Scholar, that they get that honor because they are excellent in research and they go above and beyond the classroom and excellent, excellent work, and they share what they know and their knowledge in their area. So we are very proud here of Stephanie and all the scholars at the college. I want to introduce Anthea Skoukas. She is from the University of Kansas, and she is their Education Director and Community Outreach.
Thanks, Linda. Good evening, folks. First of all, I want to explain, we're going to show some pictures as well. We thought it would be nice of you all to see some photographs that Aisha Nair has taken from her region of the world, the Black Sea region in northern Turkey, as we're sort of introducing the group. And we're getting it right now. I want to just first of all thank the Carlsons. Yeah, they're going to do that. Yeah. They just want to get it going. Yeah. Okay. I think we can. Angel, can we take the lights down a little bit now? So, let's see if I can see. So, it's a real pleasure to work with the folks, collaborate with the folks at the Carlson Center here at the Johnson County Community College. The tech staff here has been brilliant. Really appreciate that. And I especially want to thank Angel Messer, who's done a whole lot of work making all this happen this evening. So the LEAD Center and our surrounding community, really fortunate enough to be one of four communities in the United States that was allowed to take part in Arts Midwest 13-14 project entitled Caravanserai, a place where cultures meet. This program was created by Arts Midwest and supported or funded by the Doris Duke Foundation of Islamic Art to provide Americans an opportunity to engage with arts from predominantly Muslim countries, believing in the critical role that arts and the arts play in connecting the American public to the Muslim society. Now this program has been happening for 3 years now. The first year, the country was Pakistan. They visited 4 different communities. The second year was Morocco, and again, 4 different communities in the United States. This year, it has been Turkey, and they just announced, Adam just announced a while ago that next year, the country will be Malaysia, and again, it will be 4 separate communities in the United States. So it's a really great opportunity for all of us to have this experience. So this fall, some of you may have been there. We had Omar Farouk Tekbalak visiting us in Lawrence and the surrounding area and did an event here at Johnson County Community College. He did a lecture demonstration and then he did a jam with some local artists. And it was really, I think you were there. Yeah, it was really wonderful. And then in January, we had a filmmaker, Helen Esmer, Turkish filmmaker, and she was just in Lawrence, but she was only here for a few days. She has created a number of feature films. Her most recent one called Watchtower was, we showed that at Liberty Hall in Lawrence, and she worked with a bunch of high school, college age, and adult filmmakers throughout Lawrence the time she was there, and it was a fantastic opportunity for all of us. And so this spring, wonderfully and also a bit sadly for us, our final group of artists are here for the entire week. The wonderful Aishner Kolovars and her band, Alpay Sarucu, Onar Center, and Onar Deretas. And these guys have been in the United States for only 6 days, so quite amazing. I think 2 or 3 days into their time here, we put them smack dab in a middle school of about 200 children. And they did a lecture demonstration, and it was brilliant. They had them up moving and dancing on stage with them and clapping and singing. And that was just the beginning of what has been just an incredible week. They've been at KU, the Haskell, Baker, here. And to top it off, they even took part in a Turkish cooking class at the Mercantile in Lawrence. And they got a lot of pointers for the chef. And it was a wonderful night. So Aishner and the members of her band are pretty much all from the Black Sea area of northern Turkey. This is a place of varying cultural traditions, of mountains, as you can see, rivers, valleys, and of course the sea. The music you will hear tonight and some of the conversation that they will have to share with you are all of these wonderful things. And as Aishner said about the music and her love of this region, I need to feel the ground, the rocks, the cold and heat, and the pain of the people, and hear their laughter in the music. Please welcome Aishner Kolovars and her band. Thank you.
Turkey, and you know Turkey, and our country, maybe you know, has a huge number of ethnic and religious cultures in it. Today, we try to perform some examples of the cultures living in the Black Sea shore of Turkey. And our region, Black Sea region, in our region, there are Turks, Laz people, Georgians, Homshets, Armenian, Pontic Greek, many cultures living together. And if you saw that, very there are mountains, very high mountains, and very rainy place, region, all season. The mountains lie parallel to the seashore, and mountains also are divided by the valley. This is important because there are many isolated parts in this valley, and each valley has two own special cultural traditions. And our musical tradition is quite vivid, you can see music everywhere, and people in daily life, they are not consumer, they are create and live in music. And in our music, there are many special things, but especially I want to say, there is no direct connection with lyrics and melodies. And our melodies are short to remember, to easily remember. And you can improvise lyrics. You can add your story, add your feeling easily, and modify it. Now we can perform some examples, and we can talk again.
Çünkü hesap oluyor ve çok sabırlı. Thank you.
first time I began to feel well. I went to my mother and I record this my first song. My blue scarf, it's name.
Traditionally used in Black Sea region because of its size. This size of double is used in Black Sea region. There are several. This is bendir. This one is traditional in again Middle East, and this is Middle East instrument. Although it's Middle Eastern instrument, we use it because, as you heard, we have strong rhythms, and we have to use these instruments in our music. Maybe you ask for
Could you ask your questions? Could you please repeat this? We are recording this for our JCC YouTube, and I have a mic for you. If you're brave enough, you could repeat your question so everybody could hear. That would help the quality of the recording. Now there's no question.
So this is for everyone. Aishana, certainly, if you'd like to say, are you trained by any professionals, or you have mentors, famous people in your area, in your country? How do you learn your craft, not just the songs, but the instrumentation, how to play?
This is a question. I didn't individually study with any masters, but I always observed, and because of the communication, things are so broad, you know, YouTube, Facebook, blah, blah. Now you can find there most of those local players. By the way, I always collect some recordings of those local players in the towns. So I learned like that all this.
What part of the likes here?
Reason?
Reason?
Yeah. Actually, yeah, it's a good question because these instruments are commonly used in Black Sea, but the for example, the Kemenche is more common in some region, Tulum is more common in some region. They are different. As I should have told before, every valley has a different musical cultural tradition. Okay, he learned the accordion by himself.
Amazing.
He said that actually he's not from Black Sea region, but he trained this music with us since 3 years.
I began to sing at the university professionally.
Can't hear you.
I began to sing at the university professionally. My first music teacher at the university first listened to me and said that no lesson. If you learn the Western type of singing, your voice will be.
It's going to be ruined.
And I went to, let's see, I went to women, you know, and I sing with them again and again. I record and listen and listen, and I especially listen the instruments, bagpipe and lira, because and also I collect the stories and I research the research on culture, because the music in the life, and I began to hear the big symphony at the Black Sea, and this is my education.
Yes, I got study with professionals for playing these hand drums and still studying. And I am a dancer. Yeah. since I was alone, I can dance, learn, of course, in our area, I mean in Black Sea. My father also is a good dancer, but I am better now. That's all.
Assalamu alaikum. There was a reference to Rumi in the lecture. Can you give us a sample of Sufi music? Yeah, any of you from Istanbul?
Yeah.
Okay, because I had the opportunity to go to Istanbul and I have seen, you don't have to twirl and all that, just the vocal thing.
We are not trained.
Okay, folks, you have to plan. Okay, that's fine. So, just request, you don't have to accept it.
This is mainly used now today, this type of bagpipe, in Rize and the west side, east side of the Rize, generally, a small region. Naz and Hamshetsi people generally use this, and this instrument usually accompanies the dances. Unlike the Scottish or European bagpipes, it doesn't have any drums. You can see it has two pipes, and it produces a different kind of polyphony. Maybe I can play it.
Thank you.
singer and a bagpipe, but this is this kind of bagpipe is basically used in Georgia, the region called Achara. Achara is the just after the border gate of Georgia. And the difference is there's two missing holes here. In this bagpipe it has a parallel holes. Here there's two missing holes. Actually, in some regions in Turkey, they in some tunes they play covering these holes and having the same kind of thing. As you can see, this is a called horn. And this is, I think, a little. This is a little modern one because in 30-40 years before we had like this chanter. Now I will give an example, a tune from the Ajara region.
Some of you can make it over there and check it out. It's going to be—you just have an inkling of what their musical. You know, the music is beautiful, and the most fascinating thing to me about the music is that each song has such a different flavor and texture to it because it comes from various valleys in that region, and they all seem to have their own uniqueness about it. And that is what is so wonderful about this music, and the fact that they are keeping it alive. Really wonderful. So we hope that you come over to the Lead Center tomorrow at 7:30. And thank you again. Hope you really enjoy this evening. And thank you, Ashir and the band.